said Paul, gazing at his boots thoughtfully. "In the second place," continued Maria, "and I will put this shortly, because, though you read a great deal of your beloved Shakespeare, and extract his finest thoughts and ideals, yet you are very young, and cannot, perhaps, apply what you read. You may not understand my feelings in this matter. Listen, however. I am giving my Zina to this prince partly for the prince's own sake, because I wish to save him by this marriage. We are old friends. He is the dearest and best of men. He is a knightly, chivalrous gentleman, and he lives helpless and miserable in the claws of that devil of a woman at Donchanovo. Heaven knows that I persuaded Zina into this marriage by putting it to her that she would be performing a great and noble action. I represented her as being the stay and the comfort and the darling and the idol of a poor old man, who probably would not live another year at the most. I showed her that thus his last days should be made happy with love and light and friendship, instead of wretched with fear and the society of a detestable woman. Oh, do not blame Zina. She is guiltless. I am not. I admit it. For if there have been calculations, it is I who have made them. But I calculated for her, Paul. For her, not myself. I have outlived my time. I have thought but for my child. And what mother could blame me for this?" Tears sparkled in the fond mother's eyes. Mosgliakoff listened in amazement to all this eloquence, winking his eyes in bewilderment. "Yes, yes, of course. You talk well, Maria Alexandrovna. But you forget. You gave me your word. You encouraged me. You gave me my hopes. And where am I now? I have to stand aside and look a fool.